Some of you may be worried about the math that you'll encounter in a chemistry class. There's some good news. The factor unit method is a very powerful tool that will help you work many of the math problems that you encounter. Whenever I see numbers in a quiz question or an exam question, I say to myself, it's probably a math problem. And all math problems, in our text at least, can be worked in one of two ways. There's some that we have a formula for. For example, density or percentage or temperature problems. And when you have a formula, that's like a roadmap. It tells you how to set up the problem and where to substitute the numbers. If you don't have a formula, then virtually all of the other problems can be worked by the factor unit method. Let's look at one and use the factor unit method. This question says, I have a paper that's 11 inches tall. How tall is the paper in centimeters? Well, that's a pretty simple problem, and I'm sure you could work it a couple of ways. But what I promise you is that if you use the factor unit method and let it become a habit, you'll not only be able to work simple problems, but very difficult problems too. We're given some additional information. We're told that 1.0 inches is equal to 2.54 centimeters. This is an equation. It represents a truth or a fact. And from a fact, we can derive factors that help us in the factor unit method. The very first step in the factor unit method tells you where to start. And that's one of the strengths in that method. It says, exclude all the words up here and just look for the number that's given. Well, step one, we'd write down 11 inches. Step two is to sort of see where you're going. We'd like to know centimeters. So we'll use that unit over on the right-hand side. And now coming back to the left, we'll employ a factor that allows us to convert inches into centimeters. And if I have just one factor, it's always true that the unit of the answer will come in the numerator, and the unit of the denominator will be the same as we start with over here, so that inches cancels and we're given units as the product. Let's substitute in those numbers now. And associated with the unit centimeters is this 2.54. We'd put that in. Associated with inches, 1.0. We'll place it in. We'd multiply the numerators, divide by the denominators. The answer that we get is 27.94 centimeters. And we have to keep in mind significant figures. We've got two significant figures over here in a couple of places, so we'd round this off to two significant figures, 28 centimeters. The strength of this method is that by setting it up so that the unit comes out right, the number should come out right also. Let's look at another problem. In the first problem, we looked at an English to metric conversion. This time, let's look at metric to metric. 28 centimeters is how many meters? Well, here's something that you probably know, or you can find it in a table. 1 meter is equal to 100 centimeters. And again, up here, if I were to encounter this as a quiz or an exam question, I see a number, I'd say, hey, it's most likely a math problem. Do I have a formula for it? No, I'm going to use the factor unit method. Step one, simply write down the number that's given and the unit that goes with it. Step two, we'd like to know meters. Step three, here's our factor. Unit of the answer in the numerator, unit that we're given in the denominator, so that centimeters cancel. And now we'll put in the numbers that are associated with that, with those units from our equation, and multiply the numerators, divide by the denominators, we get 0.28 meters. Really pretty easy, but later on in the text you'll find that you can work even hard problems that quickly and that simply. Both of these examples have used just one factor. A little bit tougher now if we have a problem with two factors. Let's work one of those. This question asks, how many grams are in 5.0 pounds? And we're given a couple equations at the top. These might be available in a table in the text, or most likely given in a problem. One of those states that 1 gram is equal to 0.035 ounces. The other equation, 16 ounces is equal to 1 pound. And as I look at all of these numbers, I would probably say to myself, hey, this looks like a math problem. Do I have a formula for it? Well, no, I don't know the relationship between grams and pounds. So I'm going to use the factor unit method. And as I think about the factor unit method, again, I don't know the relationship between grams and pounds, and it's not contained up here in these two equations. And so that's a clue for me that I'm going to need at least two factors to work this problem. So as we begin, again, we'd start with the first step in the factor unit method, the number that's given, 5.0 pounds. I'll leave space for a factor, another factor, and here's what we'd like to know, grams. We can see that our objective is to convert pounds to grams in these two factors. So I need pounds down here in the denominator. Going back up to these two equations, here's pounds, and we know the relationship to ounces, so ounces will go in the numerator. We'd like to get rid of ounces, so ounces is in the denominator of the next factor, and we'd like to have grams, so it's in the numerator. And the first expression tells us that relationship. So now we'd take those, using these units as a guide, and simply put in the numbers that are associated with those units. And as we multiply out, my calculator gave me this answer, 2,285.7142 grams. Looks like a terrific answer. Got lots of decimal places out there, but of course we know that the answer is no more significant than the least number of significant figures back here, 2 in several places. So we need to round that answer off to 2 significant figures, rounding it a little bit. We would get 2,286, still too many digits. Even if we rounded it to 2,300, these trailing zeros are significant. So we have to use the scientific expression. We'll move the decimal 3 places to the left. We'd correct that by indicating 3 places to the right, 2.3 times 10 to the third grams in scientific notation. Again, the strength of this method is to focus upon the unit. If we make sure that the unit comes out right, then the number's going to be right also.